Thessalonians. Let's go to reading. We are on our on spirit, soul, and body, renewing the mind. Renewing the mind, renewing the mind. We are spending time on this is because it's very, very key. Renewing the mind. The mind is the battleground. The mind is the battleground. First Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 23. And Romans 12, 2. Romans 12, 2. Praise God. Romans 12, 2. First Thessalonians chapter 5. Have you showed this not too much? It's already fine. Are we there? 5:23 and then Romans chapter 12, verse 2. First Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 23. Are we there? Want to go? Want to go? Now may the God of peace himself sanctify you completely, and may your whole spirit, soul, and body be preserved blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus. Go to Romans now. Romans, let's go to Romans quickly. Romans 12. Romans 12. Romans 12, verse 2. Want to go? And do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. Hallelujah. Now, if we started, we began sharing on the spiritual and body and renew your mind. Why is this so important for you to renew your mind? Okay? I hope you are not tired of this diagram. We're going to get another one. But you have to stay here first. Now, this is you. You are not a physical body. You are a spirit. When you die, your spirit and soul will step out of your body. If you are born again, you go to heaven. If you are not born again, you sink to hell. You are not, this physical body will decay. Your real you is a spirit. You are a spirit being. You are a spirit being. Tell yourself, I am a spirit being. I have a soul. And I live in a body. My body is my house. It's not me. My body is the house I live in. That's why we say to be present in the body is to be absent from the Lord. When you are present in your body, you are absent from Jesus. When you are absent from the body, you are present with the Lord. We've had that. I know you have been here for a while now. This is, you are a spirit being, you have a soul, and you live in a physical body. And the unfortunate thing is that we spend more time taking care of the outside, the body, and we spend a lot of money going to school to go to have education to take care of the mind. But nobody, no, most people do not spend more enough time to build their spirit. Spending time to build your spirit. And is it the more understanding you have of who you really are, then you begin to change your priorities in life. Hear what Jesus, what the Holy Ghost said here through the Apostle Paul in Romans chapter 12, verse 2. He said, do not be conformed. Don't be conformed to the evil standard of this world, but be transformed by the new mind. Let me give you NLT. NLT. Now give me that down NLT. Romans 12, 2. NLT. NLT. Romans 12, 2. NLT. Look at it. Want to go? Don't copy the behavior and customs of this world, but let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think. Then you will learn to know God's way for you, which is good and pleasing and perfect. The way you think. The way you think. You see, hear me. Look at 1 John. Go to 1 John 5. 1 John 5, 29. There is something here. The day you get born again, hell is let loose. Most people think once they get born again, their problem will be solved. Then once they get born again, everything. When you get born again, the enemy will also be a major problem against you all over the place. Your relations, your friends, your office, it will look for any way it can, you know, squeeze you to, so squeeze to the world system. Look at it. 1 John 5:19. Look, where to go? We know what? That we are what? Of God. And the whole world lies under the sway of the wicked one. Give me other versions. Give me other versions. Give me other versions. Want to go? We know that we are children of God and that the world around us is under the control of the evil one. The world around where you live, around your office, where you conduct your business, the world around you is under the control, under the supervision, under the sway of Satan. But we are not under him. We belong to God. We are God's children. We are God's. So when you get born again, you are delivered from the kingdom of darkness, from the dominion of darkness, to the kingdom of light. And so what the devil will do is to do everything and to gang up around you to squeeze you to a mold. They're going to call peer pressure. Peer pressure. What is peer pressure? Peer pressure is not only for teenagers or children. Peer pressure is for everybody goes through peer pressure. Your friends, your old friends, wants you to go back to what your old sins. Everybody is putting pressure on you. Some of them, not even your parents, they want to compromise and get some things done. There are people who put pressure on their children to marry unbelievers. There are parents who put pressure on their children because they are not yet married. They are putting pressure there to marry anybody. And it's better for you to live your life completely and simply serve God than to get yourself in an ungodly relationship. Marriage is temporary. Marriage is temporary. People will pressure you to get involved in an ungodly relationship. We are going through pressure in our office. The pressure in the office to steal money, to compromise, to sleep around. There's tremendous pressure from hell once you get born again. So what, the day you make Jesus a Lord and Savior, you have declared that, hey, Satan, from today, I belong to Christ. I belong to Jesus. And once you make that determination and you make that switch, what the devil do is to make, there are many Christians, unfortunately. When we started this ministry, I discovered, me and my wife were sharing, he said, there are so many Christians who are under Satan's control. I'm talking about people who go to church that are effectively controlled by Satan. If you check an average church, you find a very small, I can say minority, who are truly controlled by the Spirit of God. The world is under Satan's control. And members of the church, most people you see around that go to churches, they obey the whims and the caprices of Satan. They obey the thinking that comes from outside that are not scriptural. They are forced to comply. Believers who are born again, going to heaven, are complying with Satan's control. They are put there. The devil is putting pressure on them, and they are taking decisions over day in, day out that lines up with Satan. Very sad. It's very sad. And let's look at it. Look at what God told the Romans. He said, don't be conformed to the evil standard of this world. They are Christians, but Christians. They are born again. He said, you are born again, but do not conform to the evil standard of this world. The world is passing away with all its lust. The lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, and the pride of life. The lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, and the pride of life. But they are all passing away. And the one is that do not be conformed to the evil standard of this world. So how do I do it? He said, be transformed by the renewing of your mind, by changing your thinking, change the way you think. Look at it. Let's go back to the scripture again. Let's go to Psalm. Psalm, where we read? Psalm 139. Okay, good. Want to go? Oh Lord, you have what? Search me and know me. You know my sitting down and my rising up. You understand my thought afar off. You comprehend my path and my lying down. And I acquainted with all my ways. Look at verse 2, then verse 17. Okay? Look at verse 2 and verse 17. Thank you. Verse 2. You know my sitting down and my rising up. You understand my thoughts, number 4. Why is thought so important? Before you speak, God already knows your thought are thinking. When I began here, I said, what is a thought? What is a word? A word is thought in capsule form. When you speak out, you are speaking what is your mind. Those days, you know, in the village, if you want to stop somebody that you respect, you want to abuse the person, you go and drink. So you go and drink that alcohol. And then when you finish drinking, you go there and say, you're talking. The reason is because you don't have the boldness to face the person. So you get drunk. But what you told that person, what you meant it. No, there's a proverb, I don't have to say it in English now. There's a proverb that says, when you are drunk and you speak out, is what was already in your mind that the alcohol lets you able to express. You know, he said in my language that when you speak out as a drunk person, the alcohol was only an enablement for you to express what was already in your mind. Your thoughts are very powerful. There are thoughts that you are going through right now that you find difficult to express, but there are even that thoughts that comes to your mind that nobody must hear it. Look, it's top secret. And the enemy uses your mind as a dumping ground. The enemy puts tremendous pressure. The mind is where the battle is fought out. Look at those who are sick in their body. When Jesus came, he defeated Satan. He removed all his powers. He delivered us from the dominion of darkness and put on the kingdom of light. So we're supposed to walk in good health. Sickness, disease is not from God. The enemy puts sickness on your body and it begins to whisper to you. You can't recover. You cannot recover. This sickness will kill you. You can't get well. You can't get well. Why? He has to spend more time bombarding your mind here because he knows that if he doesn't screw your mind, you will recover. So he will spend more time trying to whisper to your mind here, this sickness you can't recover. You are going to die. He will give you mind picture how you will die, how they will bury you, how who will come to your funeral. He's giving you a scenario from your mind here, bombarding your mind with thoughts. When Jesus defeated Satan, he took all his powers. He was only left with lies. Jesus didn't take the power of lying from him. He's a liar, and no, he depends on lies to kill. The devil uses lies, Christian. He uses lies to destroy Christians. He will tell you, this is too much. You can't get this miracle. You can't get a miracle. You can't get a miracle. You can't get a miracle. So people, Christians, are walking like unbelievers because their mind under perpetual, relentless attack from the devil. Look at verse 17. Look at it. 17 only. How? 17. Look at it. Want to go? How precious also are your thoughts to me, O God. How great is the sum of them. Does God think? Huh? You're not sure. Does God think? Some people don't even know that. Maybe you think God doesn't think. How precious are your thoughts? See, God's thought is precious. This is the summary of where I'm going to do now. I'm talking about it now. Listen every way. The God's thoughts towards you is precious. The enemy will not. No. Okay, God doesn't like you. Why is he not the one? But God's thoughts towards you is precious. Well, don't. Fortunately, yeah, church is there. Most people don't know. They don't know how God's thoughts towards them. They are not even aware of it. What is precious to you? When you use the word precious, what's precious to you? Many people, what is precious to them is to buy a car. Car is precious to them. Buying a good house is precious to them. Landed property is precious to them. Getting a wife, getting a husband, getting children. There are things that we consider precious. And those things are good. Don't get me wrong. They are good things. But do you know what the most precious thing you should pursue? Those thoughts. Is the thought of God is the most precious thing you should pursue. What is God thinking about my life? What is God thinking about my marriage? What is God thinking about my children? What is God's thoughts about what I'm facing right now? Whatever is facing you now, have you ever bothered to say, what is God's thoughts about this matter? When I used to fight my wife in those days, when we used to quarrel, before we go to bed, we argue, and then I go to bed. When you go to bed, you sleep, you forget about the quarrel. Once you wake up in the morning, put your feet on the ground, the thing that comes to your mind, the enemy brings those thoughts. Satan will bring the thoughts back to your mind. What somebody did yesterday, you bring those thoughts to your mind. The thoughts of what happened yesterday. Most thoughts. I said about 800 or 1,000 thoughts per day per person. Human beings have about 800 to 1,000 thoughts per day. And most of those thoughts are devilish thoughts. The thoughts come from outside the air to your mind. This is your spirit. The Holy Ghost is here. The Holy Spirit dwells in you. Your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost. The Holy Spirit dwells here and He constantly gives you thoughts. The Holy Spirit gives you thoughts. God's thoughts are precious. Precious thoughts come from the Holy Ghost here to your mind if you give room to it. But here from outside here is devilish thoughts. There are two sources of thoughts. God and Satan. God, thoughts that come from God and thoughts that come from Satan. If you see those who are dying of sickness, those who are dying of sickness, the enemy spends more time, listen now, convincing them that this sickness has no cure. Hey, hear me, church. There is no sickness that does not have cure. I said, somebody called me yesterday and I was talking to me about some kind of illness that the person has. And that sickness, there's no way to. I just laugh. There is no sickness that has no cure. But we are going to have to spend more time, listen now, allowing God's thoughts, spending time looking at what is God's thought about this sickness. Some people have accepted this, there's no one, no good, you cannot get away. And if you think like that, then you cannot get away. As a man thinks in his heart, so is he. As a man thinks, so is he. If you believe I'm an alcoholic, you'll be drinking. You can't stop. The devil's power over you is lies. Lies. He's lying to your mind. He's telling you lies that you cannot recover. He's a liar. The day you begin to know that whatever the devil tells you, I'm going to kill you. I will kill you. If he can kill you, why didn't he just kill you now? Why is it that he has kept you alive up to now?
You think because he likes you? Huh? Huh?
Because he can't do it. Except unless you cooperate. The devil cannot kill you unless you cooperate with the devil. So he has to spend more time here. He's very patient. The devil is very patient. He spends time. This sickness cannot, you can't get cured. 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 And then as you begin to think about it, you see, I told you, I say, what the your body, listen now. This body does not know the difference between what we are thinking and what's actually happening.
Do you get what I'm saying? Let me say it again.
When you think that you are dying, you are dying, and you allow the thought, and you give the thought, your body will begin to shut down the system.
I give example of somebody the parents used to die of bronchitis. This heart something, heart bronchitis. This man was at the age of about 30 something. The devil was telling him, this sickness will kill you. This sickness will kill you. Before she knew it, the immune system started dying, started shutting down. Shutting down. And before you knew it, that thing was coming on. Until he went to the doctor. That doctor said, that was a Christian. He said, because you are thinking like that, your body is responding to your thought. Your body is responding to your thinking.
Have you ever had news somewhere? Somebody told you news. Huh? Somebody told you something, maybe bad news. And you go to the toilet. Huh? You had bad news. Something happened. And you went to the toilet. Yeah, my wife, that happened to us a number of times. There was one time. It was me who was facing some attack from the devil. The enemy came against my head one time. I don't know where to yell to now. I don't know how long ago. Me and my wife. My wife rushed to the toilet. He didn't want man to die. There are some things you can see. You can feel some symptoms in your body. And then we will give you a mind view that this is death. And fear grips you. Fear grips you. You go to the toilet and go poo-poo. It's in the mind. You want to stop and say, hey, shut up, devil, I will not die. The devil plays mind game, and is very expert at it. He's spending money, see, but we should be concerned. We say God's thoughts for you is precious. It's precious. God's thoughts to you is precious. So we should be looking for God's thoughts. We should be thinking God's thoughts. How can I guess God's thoughts instead of spending time on devil's thoughts? You are traveling on a journey.
Church,
you have prayed about that before you travel. You say, Father, thank you, because the Bible says you will never leave me nor forsake me.
Now, you are quoting the scripture now.
The Bible says you will never leave me nor forsake me. So I thank you for journey mercies. I don't have to pray about it. It's done. Because I was saying, you will not leave me. I can't die in accident. No play, no calamity before me. I know it. The Bible says so. I believe it. I said it out of my mouth. I believe it. You say that now. You take your journey. You enter Loto. And then all of a sudden, you saw an accident. Right in your front. The motor somersaulted and then crashed. Two people died inside the motor, and then this India, and then you parked by their side. Saw them bleeding, saw they die.
Oh Lord, Father, your words, every blood sucking demon in the way, keep them away. Every blood sucking.
Why? It's fear. You're afraid. It's fear. You are already taking care of me before you left the house. You have already prayed. You have used the word. You see, it's the word that does the job. The word does the job. You are standing on the authority of the word of God. The heaven and earth will pass away. The word can never pass away. The word is yea and amen. You are standing on the word. I believe God for Septuagint. I believe God for Johnny. I thank God for it. And when I see somebody that is down the road, an accident, I'm not supposed to be panicking and start praying another fresh prayer to cancel the old one. That is not prayer of faith. That is prayer of fear. It's fear-based prayer. And is even worse than no prayer at all. The enemy has given you a mind view. A mind view of accident. You have seen that with your eyes. And the enemy brings thoughts of death to you.
When they hear about air crash, people pray all through the journey. And they're flying. Can you imagine praying through the journey, through flight, because of flight? And then because of fear of dying? He was also enter the place. Say, Father, thank you. You're like Jesus told the disciples, let us go to the other side. Jesus Christ told the disciples, say, let us go to the other side. That's all he said. And there was a tempestuous wind. The ship was rocking everywhere. And everywhere, don't do care about that. Where's the faith? The instruction was that let us go to the other side. That's another word I need. The Bible says, I will never leave you nor forsake you. I will protect your going out and your coming. It's in the Bible. I know it. I quoted it. I believe it. And I thank God for it. I enter the road. I don't have any check in my spirit. If you have a check in your spirit, say, God says, okay, no, this journey, so me can delay for 10 minutes. Yes, a check in your spirit. You obey that one. Those will give you some kind of explanation. But if once there's no check in your spirit, you pray about it, enter the road. I'm talking about going to any U.S. journey now. Go U.S. journeys. Just go U.S. journeys. Go coast scripture. Yeah, enter there. They are doing. They want to bury a dog in Kurukarufi. They are burying a new cat. A cat died in Lokoja. They are saying. You just kill one. A snake with two heads in what is it called? Zungeru. You want to go? That's what I'm saying. I'm going. I'm thinking. You are going on a purposeful journey. You use the word of God, and you enter road. What you see on the road, if you see 5-10 people die on the road, that does not concern you. 1,000 will fall by you, 10,000 by your life, it will not come near you. Then you only with your eyes, when you look and see the world of the wicked, you must see, once you begin to live in fear and dread, you are giving to the thoughts of the devil.
Look at it. See there, let's go to that same Psalm, where we are now. Go to 23. Let's go to 23. Verse 23-24, okay? Psalm 139, 23-24, okay? This is very important. Listen to this. I want to share something very powerful now. Listen. Look at that. Search me. Look at this. Search me, O God. Search me, O God. Listen to this. Say it. Read it. Say, search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my anxieties. And see if there's any wicked way in me. And lead me in the way everlasting. This anxiety can be like thoughts. Know my thoughts. Search me. You know what as a pastor, I want God to search me. I want to go to look. What kind of thing am I preaching? What kind of gospel am I preaching? Search me, O Lord. You know my heart. Try me. You know the thoughts that go through my mind. You know the thoughts. Okay? I want God to look at me. I want to take an inventory of your heart and say, what am I thinking about? What kind of things do I think about? What kind of thoughts do I go through my mind? Huh? What is it? What kind of thoughts do I have? It's because, listen now, this is very important. There are so many things that are shared as God's thoughts and it's not God's thoughts. The world where we are living in here is under Satan's control. And many things that we even share in church is not the will of God. It's not the word of God. It's not God. I don't know why God has said this morning. Huh? I say many of the things that see, there are many people, churches that gather together here and gather together in many places in the world today, Sunday, and they are not God's thoughts. There are conventions, conferences that are gathered together and they're not sharing God's thoughts. I want God to search me. I want my prayers that Father search me. And you know my heart. I don't want to share. I don't want to misrepresent you. I don't want these people, your children. I don't want to mislead your children. I don't want to tell them what is not your thoughts. There are many of us listening now. We want to transform. We want to get transformed. And we're looking for how to get transformed through prayers. Cannot transform. Let me. Where's my diagram?
That's what I'm doing. I want to get, you need to get it. I'm not just coming to preach and then just go. You need to get what I'm saying. You need to go here. Go live here with God today. When you go born again, you have a brand new spirit. A brand new, born again. You are born again in your spirit. Born again in your spirit. But your mind is programmed by Satan. Before you go born again, the devil has been programming your mind for years. Some people were raped when they were young. Some people have gone through crazy things. Relations have done them to evil. They have gone through crazy things. The mind is already full of junks. So now, listen now. You got born again. You have a born again spirit right now. In a devil programmed mind. Now, Romans 12:2 says, be don't conform to the thinking of this world. Be transformed by the renewal of your mind. Your job to do it. God will not do it for you. You will do it for yourself. Deliverance. Going for deliverance. Cannot work. Nobody can lay hands on you and say, in the name of Jesus Christ, I command you to stop taking those bad thoughts. In Jesus' name, go. Just tell the man to remove the hands. There's no point wasting your time. The thoughts are coming. You don't get it done by dry fasting. Dry, I've done dry. There's no water, no saliva, no saliva. It cannot remove your mind. I'm not against fasting. I fast once in a Wednesday, I fast, then I miss one meal. That's fasting. You think it's not fasting? Or do you know swallow saliva? That's fasting to you. If you miss a meal and you are still in God's presence, you are fasting. You can even fast television. Nigerians like dry. And that's why many people are dying. Every day, some of them people die in churches. Go fasting. You cannot get your mind renewed through fasting. You cannot get your mind renewed through deliverances. Deliverances. I've always asked the question. Those who go to deliverance. Well, okay, people have gone to deliverance for several years. What has changed their lives?
Yeah, my wife, we're talking about one of my wife's friend. This woman was a master. I don't know what to call her now. I don't know if anybody who does deliverance like her. She has major deliverances. And so the marriage was in a mess. The husband, the thing was in a mess. So when me and my wife said, okay, this is your husband. Can I go and talk to her? Let's go and talk to him. Let me sleep so I can talk to him. Let me share my life, my story with him. And he said, leave that man. No. Leave that man. Let God deal with him. Let God deal with that man. He said, you know that this man was really trying. He even followed that to church, did that church. He had to do deliverance. And then they said they would take communion. He said, the man agreed to take communion. That there is something that is worrying the man. Let the God deal with him. He said, madam, this husband not a very bad person. Let's talk to him. He said, no! He get evil spirit, what they worry about? Meanwhile, this woman is the one that actually needs help. It's amazing to think that sometimes you don't even know anything. Madam, it's not this deliverance you're doing. She's been doing deliverance. I don't know how many years that woman has been doing deliverance. I don't know how many years deliverance. And she was getting worse. And the unfortunate thing is that those who go deliverance, most of the time, see how they end up their life. See how they end up their life. Is not, you see, the solution is in the world. Your understanding of the world is what I can put you over in life. You shall know the truth, and the truth will set you free. It's the truth that you know, not deliverances that will set you free.
After a while, what happened? See the woman, the man now, after a while, the man got tired and ran away. Left her. I don't know what the story now. My wife was. Left her, abandoned her in the city, went with another person. I don't know where she went with that person. Now she went somewhere, go and stay under trees. I don't know where the man went, but the man left. It then became so difficult. All the dry fasting, the wet fasting, the semi-dry, all the other ones, they didn't work out. The woman had to sell up. She had a store in the Western market. She sold the thing, and now he looked at the east. She stayed somewhere now in the east. Out of shame. Meanwhile, this world will have done the job. The world.
Just spending more time on the word of God. Just hearing word that is this faith-based word will have done the job. People are looking for a shortcut in deliverance. Shortcut to deliverance is long cut. Most Christians who are going for deliverance, they are not even, they have no business in any demon. They are aware, they are okay. The problem they have is their flesh. You don't need deliverance, this church. You need to renew your mind with the word of God. Do not be conformed to the evils of this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind. The biggest enemy you have is that person that you are looking at the mirror in the moment you go in the morning. When you woke up in the morning, your biggest enemy is not even the devil. You know the biggest enemy? Check that person you are seeing in the mirror. That's your biggest enemy. Your flesh. You've got to put that flesh under. He said, be transformed and do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. It is in the will of God that you get whatever belongs to you. If you are not in the will of God, no, see, God doesn't put his provision outside of his will. When you should be in church, you are pursuing one crazy like somewhere. You cannot meet the will of God there. You have to prioritize your life and say, what is important to God? What is God's thoughts about this thing? Look at Genesis. Let me show you something quickly in Genesis. Genesis chapter 5, chapter 6. Look at it for that time. Let's take a quick look at it. Genesis chapter 5. Genesis chapter 6. Verse 5. Okay? Genesis 6, 5. Look at it. Then the Lord saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every intent of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. Thoughts of men. You see, back up to the other verse now. Verse 11 to 12. Give me 11 to 12. Okay? Now look at it. The earth also was corrupt, look at it, before God. And the earth was filled with violence. So God looked upon the earth, and indeed it was corrupt. For all flesh are corrupt their way on the earth. What was God's response here? He cleaned everywhere except Noah. The world you are living in is corrupt. The world, see, we cannot pray for the world to get better. The world cannot get better. This will only get worse for the world. But for believers, it's time for us to shine. If you don't conform to this standard, what happened right now in Noah's time? This is sex, stealing, bribery and corruptions, murder, robbery, hired assassin, bomb blast, terrorism. There were all kinds of crazy things that were taking place. It's a replica right now of what happened that time. Hear me, church. We are not of the world. We are in the world. We are not of the world. We are in the world, but we are not of the world. And so because of that, hear me, church, no matter what is going on right now, because see, we cannot save our world. No, we can't save our world. We can only preach people to get born again. Things will be getting worse. Because as we draw to the end of the age, things will only get worse. But for us Christians, things will get better for us. I don't know. You didn't get what I said now. I say for you as a child of God, things will only get better for you. Amen. Why it is worse for the people outside, it will get better for you. But here, see the scenario here. Here was Noah and his people and everything. The whole world was under Satan's control. And they said there was violence, corruption, illicit sex, anything evil you can think of. And those things affect the world. Yeah, if you go to a house, listen now. If you go to any house where they are fighting, husband and wife fighting, there's no love between the family. You enter the house, even if they give you food there, you don't feel like eating. Unless you are a really hungry man, you have no standard. Okay? There are some places, if they even serve you food, you say, excuse me, I'm okay, thank you. Even though you're hungry. The atmosphere is tense. They bring for you, they say, you go eat. If I say, no, I'm okay, thank you. Anywhere there is strife, listen now. Anywhere there is strife, anywhere evil is prevailing, is heaviness, there's darkness. It's the sense of darkness. There's darkness present there.
If you go to a house where they are happy, the old man is happy, the wife is happy, and the God's love is ready in that house. Hear me, when you enter that place, even you get healed.
There was a young guy came to the house, just coming to the house, right before we even pray for him. Just sit down. He was healed. Just sitting down in the parlor. Before we even came out. God's presence. The world is where we are now. We are where we are in the world. Most people are now. Because of the Satan's heaviness, there's darkness around us. There's darkness all over the place. That's why, as a born again believer, you can't conform to that darkness. You ought to be different from them. We should not allow the same sickness that is killing unbelievers to kill us. We should stand against Satan.
But if you allow strife, unforgiveness, problems that have been setting the unbeliever to come against you, you will reap the same consequences with them, even though you are a child of God. Go to homes, listen now. Go to families, listen now. Where husband and wife, they are always quarreling. Where there is so much strife, unforgiveness and malice and everything. Guess what? Look at even the children. The children there. The children are under the yoke of the enemy. You can't see children excited and joyous. No, because that darkness has enveloped them. The children are even in that darkness.
One of our friends came from Lagos to our house to see us. My wife's friend. He said, "These are your children. Are there children in this house?" That's from years back now. When they saw the children, he said, don't they fight here? She spent a night with us. Spent one night with us. He said, "Come, your children, they don't fight. No fight here. There's no fight in this house." He was surprised there's no fighting. We're not. Say, how come who can achieve this one? They're not fighting. They go to their room, they do their things, and everything. You just see them moving, everybody go out. No fighting. There's no. You can't see a violence. You must stay only one night. I was surprised. No, two nights. She had to speak out and say, "Look, this is strange." Because she knows what the battleground in the house. It's battleground. And to all, it's not strange. It's the normal thing with the children. Because if we as parents, listen now, if we as parents, we maintain that sanity and there is joy of the Lord and we are not walking in strife and terrible malice and unforgiveness, it can't affect our children. We are not living that line. The life we are not living, we cannot affect our children. Only the life we are living that can affect them. So the children are happy. Everybody's excited. Everybody looks at joy. There's no, somebody's in a bad mood. I don't know, this one. No. Even if you woke up with a bad mood, you are going to straighten your face before you come out. God, no, I'm not going to meet anybody who use bad mood to meet you. The bad mood, you know, when you're in a bad mood, you like everybody to be in the bad mood. Everybody keep malice. Keep on.
There is darkness in that kind of place. And anywhere you have darkness, the devil steal, kill and destroy. That's what happened here. The devil has come to steal, to kill, and to destroy. But hear me, church. That is why we cannot afford to conform to the evils that we can't afford it. It's too expensive for us. When others are stealing money in the office, we can't afford to tell a barrel be taking money. No. We can't afford it. It's too expensive. When we are sleeping around and compromising like crazy, we can't afford it. Because anywhere you see heaviness, where you see heaviness, you are going to find evil there. You are going to find premature death. You are going to find sickness and disease. There will be all kinds of men who can attempt to corrupt. We are the son of the world. We tell your neighbor, you are the son of the world. You are the son of the world. Hallelujah. And let's go to 2 Corinthians 4, verse 3 to 4. And let me show you something quickly before I shut up. Now, 2 Corinthians 4, verse 3 to 4. Look at it. What is the heaviness doing in the world right now? There's so much heaviness, and that's why it's affecting the gospel. Look at it. Look at it. But even if our gospel is vain, it is vain to those who are perishing. Whose mind the God of this age has blinded, who do not believe, let the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine on them. Give me other versions. This is important. He says, what is your veil? Veil. Look at it. Veil. Gospel is veil.
If the good news we preach is hidden behind a veil, it is hidden only from people who are perishing. Satan, look at that. Satan, who is the God of this world, has blinded the minds of those who don't believe. They are unable to see the glorious light of the good news. They don't understand about the glory of Christ, who is the exact likeness of God. If you see, if you have those who went to heaven and saw the vision of heaven, nobody can go to heaven and want to come back home. Are you aware of that? Nobody can see heaven and want to come back here. People in America, in Asia, who have seen heaven, the same story of light. They see light, they see joy, they see peace. They have all the wild out here. You go see, like, I don't know if you have seen a bush before. Huh? The village. You stay maybe, I don't know which is worse now. Let me not make any mention anywhere, anywhere. Somebody's living here. You stay in the bush, in Gwari, one Gwari house somewhere before you reach Kefi. Huh? Before you reach Kefi. Gwagwalape. Huh? And then you now move from Gwagwalape to somewhere in Matama, for instance. With a very big mansion, everywhere is everything fine there. And now come to you and say, after you spend the night there, they say that they wait for you. Go, I wait for you. You say, go, Galapi. No, I don't go. Those who go to heaven, and heaven is nicer than anywhere in the world, those who go to heaven, they don't want to ever come back. Why? They see the light of God there, the peace, the joy that you can never find anywhere here. We only those of us who are Christians have a small clip of it. They see what they can know. You can never compare. Heaven is so good. And that shows the presence of God. Anywhere you have God presence, you see light, you see peace, you see joy. And here on earth, we are preaching the gospel on TV, on radio, across the world, on satellite, internet. We are watching the Christian people preaching on the internet. They are working everywhere, and yet only few conversions. Not many people are born again. Why? The gospel is being preached every day, all over the place. They are doing crusade. They are doing conventions, and yet most of the world are still in darkness. Why? The reason, listen is this. The gospel is veiled. It's veiled. The enemy is doing everything to steal the word of God. He's doing everything to douse the word of God. When you hear the word of God, when God tells you, I say, go to that church there. They say, no, I don't want that. Devil said, no, don't go there. Go here. It diverts people. And so they go to a place where they cannot know, they cannot hear the true gospel. And many people are in churches all over the world. They are in churches and they're not even born again. We have asked people, me and my wife say, are you saved? Are you born again? Yes, I'm born again. How do I you born again? I go to so church. That's all. What makes you born again? You go to a church? You join a church? The gospel is being veiled. The people are perishing. The enemy covers them. They cannot hear the true gospel. People are moving up and down like a chicken haircut up. They are trying to get something. Trying to look for money. Get money there. And they are not seeking for the thoughts of God. Occupy, those who are even born again who are Christians, that occupies their mind with the vain pursuits of this world, the vain things of this world. So you preach the gospel, people hear the gospel, say, okay, maybe tomorrow, next week I'll go, next month I'll go. And then most of them end up dying in sin and going to hell because of the heaviness. There's an enemy, Satan, who is trying to steal the word of God. And even among the so-called born-again believers, there is no fruit. People are living from day to day and no changes in their life. Things are not changing for them. They are in the same mess they were in last year, the year before, the year after, the one before. The year in year, they are in a worse mess. Why? It's because they are not seeking the thoughts of God. God's thoughts about your finances will make you a millionaire. Knowing God's thoughts about the kind of business you should invest in, the kind of business, it's not every business that is meant for you.
Are you aware of that? It's not every business you can do and prosper. It's not every church you can go to and prosper there. You can't just marry any man. You cannot just marry any woman. You can't just marry a man or a woman just because he has a touch. Or marry a lady just because she has the shape. There are people that you cannot, you can even they're in church, you cannot be yoked with them. If they will destroy you. You see, there are people, they don't know somebody who don't know, I want to enter. And you enter and then you start getting the rest of your life. There's a way that seems right to a man. The end of it is destruction. We ought to be seeking and panting after the heart of God. What is God's thoughts? What is God thinking about? What is God thought about this business? What is God thought about this proposal? What is God's thoughts? It's not every opportunity. It's not every opportunity that is God. I will say it again. It's not every opportunity that you see that is God. Not every door that opens that is God. It's not every open door is God. You can't just take up any job. You ought to spend some time and seek the mind of God. God's will for you, they are numerous for you, numerous thoughts, and they are precious. They are precious. They will give you job. They will give you money. They will give you peace. They will give you prosperity. Whatever you are believing God for, what is the balance gospel? What is God's thoughts?
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
I'm sure you have had a good time. We are not out of message, but we are out of time on this program today.
Okay.
If you are not born again, the first place to start is to get born again.
Brand new spirit.
That is the beginning point.
Amen.
For you to have a brand new spirit.
Amen.
Because if you are not born again, your spirit is dead towards God.
That's right.
Your spirit needs to be born again.
Mm.
So for you to ask for a brand new spirit now from God, say this simple prayer after me.
Mm.
I mean it from your heart.
That's
say,
right.
Heavenly Father.
Heavenly Father.
Accept Jesus Christ.
Accept Jesus Christ.
As your son.
As your son.
That you send. To save me.
Save me.
I accept your gift of salvation right now. Your gift of a new spirit right now.
A new spirit right now.
In Jesus' name.
Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
If you said that simple prayer, you meant it when you said it. You are born again.
Hallelujah.
Congratulations.
Amen.
You have a brand new spirit.
Hallelujah.
Right now. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
If you are sick in your body, God also wants to heal you.
Amen.
So lay your hands on the area while I agree with you in prayer.
That's right.
Sickness and disease, I speak to you in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Christ.
Amen.
To depart from these people.
Yes, sir.
And let them go.
Amen.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
The Bible says that the name of Jesus Christ, every name must bow. So every form of sickness and disease,
bow.
Be gone.
Bow out.
In Jesus'
Amen.
Name.
Praise God.
Go find a living church.
That's right.
Where your new spirit will be nurtured.
Amen.
Where you will grow.
Amen.
And Jesus. See you tomorrow.
A new anointing. It's a gathering of faithfuls with strength like an eagle.
Challenges in life and everything is going haywire. Only your spirit can sustain you.
Join Pastor and Mrs. Loto at the Eagle Christian Center for Sunday worship service by 9 a.m. Tuesday Bible study and leadership meeting by 6 p.m. And Friday's prayer and healing service also by 6 p.m. Venue. Suite A14, ground floor, Roaches Plaza by Tantalizers, Wusei Zone 3, Abuja. For further details, call 0803-965-8883 or email eaglechristiancenter@yahoo.com. Make it a date with the Lord and experience an atmosphere of God's presence at the Eagle Christian Center. God bless you.
You woke up in the morning and you get this. Or you run and jog. You do something stronger.
cannot remove your mind. Listen. I'm not against fasting. I fast once in a Wednesday, I fast, then I miss one meal. That's fasting. You think it's not fasting? Or do you know swallow saliva? That's fasting to you. If you miss a meal and you are still in God's presence, you are fasting. You can even fast television. Nigerians like dry. And that's why many people are dying every day. Sometimes people die in churches because of fasting. You cannot get your mind renewed through fasting. You cannot get your mind renewed through deliverances. Deliverances. I've always asked the question, those who go for deliverance, well, okay, people have gone to deliverance for several years. What has changed their lives? Me and my wife were talking about one of my wife's friend. This woman was a master, I don't know what to call her now. I don't know if anybody who does deliverance like her. She has major deliverances. And so the marriage was in a mess, the husband, the thing was in a mess. So when me and my wife said, okay, this is your husband. Can I go and talk to her, to him? Let's go and talk to him. Let me meet him so I can talk to him. Let me share my life, my story with him. And he said, leave that man. No. Leave that man. Let God deal with him. Let God deal with that man. He said, you know that this man was really trying. Even followed that to church, their church. Yeah, they do deliverance. And then they said they take communion. He said, the man not going to drink communion. That there is something that is worrying the man. Let the God deal with him. He said, madam, this husband not a very bad person. Let's talk to him. He said, no! He got evil spirit with the warrior. Meanwhile, this woman is the one that actually needs help. It's amazing to think that sometimes you don't want anything. Madam, it's not this deliverance you're doing. She's been doing deliverance. I don't know how many years that woman has been doing deliverance. I don't know how many years deliverance. And she was getting worse. And the unfortunate thing is that those who go deliverance, most of the time, see how they end up their life. See how they end up their life. Is not, you see, the solution is in the world. Your understanding of the world is what I can put you over in life. You shall know the truth, and the truth will set you free. It's the truth that you know, not deliverances that will set you free.
After a while, what happened? You see, the man got tired and ran away. Left her. I don't know what the story now. My wife was. Left her, abandoned her in the city, went with another person. I don't know where she went with that person. Now she went somewhere, go and stay under trees. I don't know where the man went, but the man left. The thing became so difficult. All the dry fasting, the wet fasting, the semi-dry, all the other ones, they didn't work out. The woman had to sell up. She had a store in the Western market. She sold the thing, and now he looked to the east. She stayed somewhere now in the east. Out of shame. Meanwhile, this world will have done the job. The world. Just spending more time on the word of God. Just hearing word that is this faith-based word will have done the job. People are looking for shortcuts in deliverance. Shortcuts to deliverance is long cut. Most Christians who are going for deliverance, they have no business in any demon. They are aware, they are okay. The problem they have is their flesh. You don't need deliverance, this church. You need to renew your mind with the word of God. Do not be conformed to the evils of this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind. The biggest enemy you have is that person that you are looking at the mirror in the morning. When you go in the morning. When you woke up in the morning, your biggest enemy is not even the devil. You know the biggest enemy? Check that person you are seeing in the mirror. That's your biggest enemy. Your flesh. You've got to put that flesh under. He said, be transformed and do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. It is in the will of God that you get whatever belongs to you. If you are not in the will of God, you cannot see. God doesn't put his provision outside of his will. When you should be in church, you are pushing one crazy like somewhere. You cannot meet the will of God there. You have to prioritize your life and say, what is important to God? What is God's thoughts about this thing? Look at Genesis. Let me show you something quickly in Genesis. Genesis chapter 5, chapter 6. Look at it at that time. Let's take a quick look at it. Genesis chapter 5.
Genesis chapter 6. Verse 5. Okay? Genesis 6, 5. Look at it. Then the Lord saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every intent of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. Thoughts of men. Thoughts of men. You see, back up to the other verse now. Verse 11 to 12. Give me 11 to 12. Okay? Now look at it. The earth also was corrupt. Look at it. Before God. And the earth was filled with violence. So God looked upon the earth, and indeed it was corrupt. For all flesh accorded their way on the earth. What was God's response here? He cleaned everywhere except Noah. The world you are living in is corrupt. The world, see, we cannot pray for the world to get better. The world cannot get better. This will only get worse for the world. But for believers, it's time for us to shine. If you don't conform to this standard, what happened right now in Noah's time? Illicit sex, stealing, bribery and corruptions, murder, robbery, hired assassin, bomb blast, terrorism. There were all kinds of crazy things that were taking place. It's a replica right now of what happened that time. Hear me, church. We are not of the world. We are in the world. We are not of the world. We are in the world, but we are not of the world. And so because of that, hear me, church. No matter what is going on right now, because see, we cannot save our world. No, we can't save our world. We can only preach people to get born again. Things will be getting worse. Because as we draw to the end of the age, things will only get worse. But for us Christians, things will get better for us. I don't know. You didn't get what I said now. I say for you as a child of God, things will only get better for you. Amen. Why it is worse for the people outside, it will get better for you. But here, see the scenario here. Here was Noah and his people and everything. The whole world was under Satan's control. And they said there was violence, corruption, illicit sex, anything evil you can think of. And those things affect the world. Yeah, if you go to a house, listen now. If you go to any house where they are fighting, husband and wife fighting, there's no love between the family. You enter the house, even if they give you food there, you don't feel like eating. Unless you are a really hungry man, you have no standard. Okay? There are some places, if they even serve you food, you say, excuse me, I'm okay, thank you. Even though you're hungry. The atmosphere is tense. They bring for you, they say, you go eat. If I were you, I say, no, I'm okay, thank you. Anywhere there is strife, listen now. Anywhere there is strife, anywhere evil is prevailing, is heaviness, there's darkness, it's a sense of darkness. There's darkness present there. If you go to a house where they are happy, the husband is happy, the wife is happy, and the God's love is reigning in that house. Hear me, when you enter that place, even you get healed. There was a young guy came to the house. Just come into the house. That boy, we won't pray for him. Just sit down in the parlor. He was healed. Just sitting down in the parlor. The boy came out. God's presence. The world is where we are now. We are where we are in the world. Most people are now. Because of the Satan's heaviness, there is darkness around us. There is darkness all over the place. That's why as a born-again believer, you can't conform to that darkness. You ought to be different from them. We should not allow the same sickness that is killing unbelievers to kill us. We should stand against it. But if you allow strife, unforgiveness, problems that are besetting the unbeliever to come against you, you will reap the same consequences with them, even though you are a child of God. Go to homes, listen now. Go to families, listen now. Where husband and wife, they are always quarreling. Where there's so much strife, unforgiveness and malice and everything. Guess what? Look at even the children. The children there. The children are under the yoke of the enemy. You can't see children excited and joyous. No, because that darkness has enveloped them. The children are even in that darkness.
One of our friends came from Lagos to our house to see us. My wife's friend.
He said, "These are your children. Are there children in this house?" That's from years back now. When he saw the children, he said, don't they fight here? She spent a night with us. Spent one night with us. He said, "Come, your children, they don't fight. No fight here. There's no fight in this house." He was surprised there's no fighting. See, how come who can achieve this one? They're not fighting. They go to their room, they do their things, and you just see them moving, everybody go out. No fighting. There's no, you can't see a violence. This woman stayed only one night. I was surprised. No, two nights. She had to speak out and say, "Look, this is strange." Because she knows what the battleground in the house. It's battleground. And to all, it's not strange. It's the normal thing with our children. Because if we as parents, listen now, if we as parents, we maintain that sanity and there is joy of the Lord and we are not walking in strife and terrible malice and unforgiveness, it can't affect our children. Because we are not living that life. The life we are not living cannot affect our children. Only the life we are living that can affect them. So the children are happy. Everybody's excited. Everybody's joy. There's no because somebody's in a bad mood. No. Even if you just woke up, with a bad mood, you are going to straighten your face before you come out. God, no, I don't go to meet anybody who use bad mood to meet you. Bad mood, you know, when you have bad mood, you like everybody to be in the bad mood. Everybody keep malice, keep on. No. There's darkness in that kind of place. And anywhere you have darkness, the devil steal, kill, and destroy. That's what happened here. The devil has come to steal, to kill, and to destroy. But hear me, church. That is why we cannot afford to conform to the evils that we can't afford it. It's too expensive for us. When others are stealing money in the office, we can't afford to tell a baron be taking money. No. We can't afford it. It's too expensive. When people are sleeping around and compromising like crazy, we can't afford it. Because anywhere you see heaviness, you are going to find evil there. You are going to find premature death. You are going to find sickness and disease. There will be all kinds of men who can attempt to corrupt. We are the son of the world. We tell your neighbor, you are the son of the world. You are the son of the world. Hallelujah. And let's go to 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 3 to 4. And let me show you something quickly before I shut up. Now, 2 Corinthians chapter 4. Verse 3 to 4. Look at it. What is the heaviness doing in the world right now? There's so much heaviness, and that's why it's affecting the gospel. Look at it. One, two, go. Look at it. But even if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing, whose mind the God of this age has blinded, who do not believe, lest the light of the gospel, the glory of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine on them. Give me other versions. This is important. You see, what does it mean? Veil. Look at veil. Look at it. Veil. Gospel is veil. If the good news we preach is hidden behind a veil, it is hidden only from people who are perishing. Satan, look at that. Satan, who is the God of this world, has blinded the minds of those who don't believe. They are unable to see the glorious light of the good news. They don't understand this message about the glory of Christ, who is the exact likeness of God. If you have those who went to heaven and saw the vision of heaven, nobody can go to heaven and want to come back home. Are you aware of that? Nobody can see heaven and wants to come back here. People in America, in Asia, who have seen heaven, the same story of light. They see light, they see joy, they see peace. They have all the wild out here. Because I don't know if you have seen a bush before. Huh? The village. We stay maybe, I don't know which is worse now. Let me not make any mention anywhere, somebody's living here. You stay in the bush, in Gwari, one Gwari house somewhere before you reach Kefi. Huh? Before you reach Kefi. Gwagwalape. Huh? And then you now move from Gwagwalape to somewhere in Matama, for instance. With a very big mansion, everything fine there. And now come to you and say, after you spend the night there, they say that they wait for you. Go Galapi, I wait for you. You say, go Galapi? No, I don't go. Those who go to heaven
And heaven is nicer than anywhere in the world. Those who go to heaven, they don't want to ever come back. Why? They see the light of God there. The peace, the joy that you can never find anywhere here. We only those of us who are Christians have a small clip of it. They see what they can know. You can never compare. Heaven is so good. And that shows the presence of God. Anywhere you have God present, you see light. You see peace. You see joy. And here on earth, we are preaching the gospel on TV, on radio, across the world, on satellite. Internet, we are watching Christian people preaching on the internet. They are working everywhere, and yet only a few conversions. Not many people are getting born again. Why? The gospel is being preached every day, all over the place. They are doing crusade. They are doing conventions, and yet most of the world are still in darkness. Why? The reason, listen is this. The gospel is veiled. It's veiled. The enemy is doing everything to steal the word of God. He's doing everything to douse the word of God. When you hear the word of God, when God tells you, I say, go to that church there. Go again. They say, no, I don't want that. Devil say, no, don't go there. Go here. It diverts people. And so they go to a place where they cannot hear the true gospel. And many people are in churches all over the world. They are in churches and they're not even born again. We have asked people, me and my wife say, are you saved? Are you born again? Yes, I'm born again. How do you born again? I go to so church. That's all. What makes you born again? You go to a church or join a church? The gospel is being veiled. The people are perishing. The enemy covers their. They cannot hear the true gospel. People are moving up and down like a chicken haircut up. They are trying to get something, trying to look for money. Get money there, get money there. And they are not seeking for the thoughts of God. Satan occupies, those who are even born again, who are Christians, that occupies their mind with the vain pursuits of this world. The vain things of this world. So you preach the gospel, people hear the gospel, say, okay, maybe tomorrow I go. Next week I go. Next month I'll go. The other one go. And then most of them end up dying in sin and going to hell. Because of the heaviness. There's an enemy, Satan, who is trying to steal the word of God. And even among the so-called born-again believers, there is no fruit. People are living from day to day and no changes in their life. Things are not changing for them. They are in the same mess they were in last year, the year before, the year after, the one before. The year in year, they are in a worse mess. Why? It's because they are not seeking the thoughts of God. God's thoughts about your finances will make you a millionaire. Knowing God's thoughts, about the kind of business you should invest in, the kind of business, it's not every business that is meant for you. Are you aware of that? It's not every business you can do and prosper. It's not every church you can go to and prosper there. You can't just marry any man. You cannot just marry any woman. You can't just marry a man or a woman just because he has a mustache. Or marry a lady just because she has the shape. There are people that they're in church, you cannot be yoked with them. If they will destroy you. You see, there are people, they don't know somebody who knows, no, I want to enter. And you enter and then you start regretting what that's of your life. There's a way that seems right to a man. The end of it is destruction. We ought to be seeking and panting after the heart of God. What is God's thoughts? What is God thinking about? What is God thought about this business? What is God thought about this professor? What is God's thoughts? It's not every opportunity. It's not every opportunity that is God. I will say it again. It's not every opportunity that you see that is God. Not every door that opens that is God. It's not every open door is God. You can't just take up any job. You ought to spend some time and seek the mind of God. God's will for you, they are numerous for you, numerous thoughts, and they are precious. They are patient. They will give you job. They will give you money. They will give you peace. They will give you prosperity. Whatever they are believing God for. What is the plan's gospel? What is God's thoughts? Let's pray. Father, we thank
yourself. If you limit God based on what you have, how much you have in your account, how much money you have, you are limiting him. God wants to supernaturally open doors for you that no man can shut. This week, in the name of Jesus Christ. Just say, Heavenly Father, I believe in my heart, in accordance with your word. The Bible says, I wear what I say. I believe that money, wealth, and riches are found in my house. I am prosperous. I am in health as my soul prospers. I declare I am free from sickness, from disease. Sickness, disease, I resist you. Leave my presence in the name of Jesus Christ. The Bible says, by the stripes of Jesus, I am healed. The Bible says, none was feeble among their tribe. None will be feeble in my family. In the name of Jesus, I'm done with sickness and disease. I'm free. Jesus has set me free. I'm free indeed. I declare that I attract money. This week, I call money in from the north, from the west, from the east, into my hands. Money, come now. In Jesus' name, I believe I receive. Thank you, Father. Thank you for so much favor. I'm highly favored. This week, my God will cause people to favor me in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord. I believe I receive. I believe I receive. It's done in Jesus' name. Amen. See you tomorrow at the Bible school. Those of you in the Bible school, praise God. And let's be coming to Bible school early so we can cover more grounds. Okay, praise God. Then you can get to this tip. Today's message, you need to listen to it carefully. There is so much inside one message. You need to listen carefully and take your note. God bless you. If you are not,
praise the Lord. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
We are delighted today to welcome you to your favorite program, Eagle Christian Voice of Victory.
Yes,
today's program is truly designed to give you victory once you do it. Today, we shall be talking about your spirit, soul, and body. Spirit, soul, and body. Pay close attention. See you later. Praise the Lord. It is a joy to welcome you to your popular program, Eagle Christian Voice of Victory. Today's edition is going to be very, very interesting. We shall be talking about spirit, soul, and body. Spirit, soul, and body. That as a human being, you have a spirit, you live in a body, and you have a soul. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
We are delighted to welcome you to today's edition of Eagle Christian Voice of Victory.
Hallelujah.
And we are so sure and give praise to God on your behalf that you have been experiencing victory.
Amen.
As you put it to practice, the nuggets you have been learning on this program.
Amen.
Today, we shall be talking about your spirit, your soul, and your body.
Hallelujah.
As a woman, you have a spirit, you live in a body, and you have a soul.
Amen.
Have a good time. God bless you.
Amen.
See you later.
That's right.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
I welcome you to your favorite program, Eagle Christian Voice of Victory.
Sure.
Today, we shall be discussing or learning about how to renew your mind.
Amen.
How to renew your mind in the light of the Word of God.
Amen.
How to have your mind renewed.
Amen.
See you later. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
I'm sure you have had a good time. We are not out of message, but we are out of time on this program today.
Okay.
If you are not born again, the first place to start is to get born again.
Brand new spirit.
That is the beginning point.
Amen.
For you to have a brand new spirit.
Amen.
Because if you are not born again, your spirit is dead towards God.
That's right.
So your spirit needs to start aright. Your spirit needs to be recreated.
Amen.
Your spirit needs to be born again.
Mm.
So for you to ask for a brand new spirit now from God, say this simple prayer after me.
Mm.
I mean it from your heart.
That's
say,
right.
Heavenly Father.
Heavenly Father.
Accept Jesus Christ.
Accept Jesus Christ.
As your son.
As your son.
That you send.
That you send.
To save me.
Save me.
I accept your gift of salvation right now.
Accept your salvation right now.
Your gift of a new spirit right now.
A new spirit right now.
In Jesus' name.
Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
If you said that simple prayer and you meant it when you said it, you are born again.
Hallelujah.
Congratulations.
Amen.
You have a brand new spirit right now.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
If you are sick in your body, God also wants to heal you.
Amen.
So lay your hands on the area while I agree with you in prayer.
That's right.
Sickness and disease, I speak to you in the name of Jesus
Amen.
Christ
Amen.
To depart from these people
yes, sir.
And let them go.
Amen.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
The Bible says that the name of Jesus Christ, every nail must bow. So every form of sickness and disease,
bow.
Be gone.
Bow out. Jesus.
In Jesus'
Amen.
Name.
Praise God.
Go find a living church.
That's right.
Where your new spirit will be nurtured.
Amen.
Where you will grow.
Amen.
In Jesus. See you tomorrow.
Amen.
Okay, you don't want to do conclusion, no? Anyway, no problem. Okay, right. It's okay. It's okay. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
If you are not born again, you have a dead spirit. And the place to start is to get a brand new spirit from the Lord. How do you get a brand new spirit? You simply believe in the Lord Jesus Christ as the Son of God that was sent to save you. So if you want to get a brand new spirit, say this simple prayer after me. I mean it from your heart. Say, Heavenly Father, I accept Jesus Christ as my Lord and my Savior. I believe that it's your Son that you sent to save me. Thank you, Lord, for saving me. Thank you, Lord, for giving me a brand new spirit. In Jesus' name. Amen. If you prayed that prayer and you truly meant it when you did, you have a brand new spirit. When you have a new baby, you nurture them to grow. You take care of them. So you need to take care of your new spirit. And how do you do that? You do that by privately looking for a good church where your spirit will be nurtured, where you will be taught the word of God, where your mind can be renewed. So go find a living church. If you are sick in your body, there's also provision for that. There's provision for healing and wholeness for you. So lay your hand on the area while I pray for you. Sickness and disease in the lives of these ones watching right now, be gone in Jesus' name. Thank you, Father. See you tomorrow. Bye-bye.
This is a mission, the Great Commission, to make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. The word of the Lord.
Eagle
Christian
Center.
Voice of victory.
We are here to reach you again.
We bring you good news.
We say we love you.
You will never be the same again.
Join Pastor and Mrs. Loto at the Eagle Christian Center for Sunday worship service by 9 a.m. Tuesdays, Bible studies and leadership training by 6 p.m. Fridays, prayer and healing service also by 6 p.m. Then visit A14 Grand Floor, Rogers Plaza, by Loki Christian Bookshop, which is on 3, Abuja. For further details, call 0803-965-8883 or email eaglechristiancenter@yahoo.com. Make it a date with the Lord and experience God's transformation power in your life.
You will never be the same.